Good evening. We start with Pakistan today. Pakistani Ambassador Abdul Basit had spoken to NewsX and given us enough to talk about. The familiar Pakistani positions of not supporting terror, not supporting anything related to the unrest happening in Jammu and Kashmir, notwithstanding, he did indicate one positive trait. But on the fact that the FATF, the Financial Task Force, International Financial Task Force, had put Pakistan on a three-month notice to stop supporting and financing the JUD, the Jamaat-ul-Dawa, the Falah-e-Insaniyat, and many other such organizations connected to Hafiz Saeed. The world for Hafiz Saeed has suddenly shrunk. Pakistan can no longer run away from the claims. We say the claims, they are of course part of the reality of Pakistan, that it supports as a part of an arm of an establishment agency. Organizations like the Falah-e-Insaniyat, the Jamaat-ul-Dawa, connected to the LAP, connected to people and individuals like Hafiz Saeed. Now, the ambassador has told NewsX that he's under house arrest, and if there is strong evidence found against him, the system in Pakistan will go forward as per law. Most security experts in India say take that with more than a grain of salt. We have a fantastic panel to discuss how short or how small, rather, has Pakistan's world become, with the FATF perhaps triggering a slide of more sanctions coming in from either the US or the EU, perhaps even India. Take a look at the story first. I'll introduce my panel later.
Atankwad aur atankwadi soch ka tyag anivarya.
In New Delhi, India and Bangladesh came closer than ever before, based on the common need to fight terror. Terror emanating from a country both nations have a turbulent history with. But with the US turning its screws on Pakistan and other regional powers supporting India's stand on terror, a shaken Pakistan can only hem and haw.
Hafiz Saeed is not being tried on Mumbai.
He hem and haw.
Hafiz Saeed is not being tried on Mumbai. As far as Hafiz Saeed is concerned, you know that we have put him under house arrest, and that is in pursuance of our national action plan, which is being implemented across the country and across the board. And if there is any solid evidence against him, obviously he cannot also escape the law of the land.
That evidence has been collected by the Federal Investigating Agency of Pakistan. So what Mr. Basit was saying is baseless, totally baseless.
I think really serves no purpose, because it gives support to this way of thinking.
You should take whatever Pakistan is saying or their envoys are saying with a pinch of salt, because the fact is they cannot and they will not accept it. Without that, credibility is the issue.
Evidence kitne baar de chuke, aapko kya evidence chahiye? Main saboot hu, mujhe goli lagi hai 26 kehra mein, kitne jhan saboot hai, unhe goli lagi aur maine to kasab ko dekha bhi tha. Aaj main janti hu takleef kya hui.
India wale ko action lena chahiye un log ko. Pakistan hamesha jhoot bolta hai ki main ye nahi kiya, wo nahi kiya. Abhi log kitna hum log ko takleef hai na, wo log kaam karte hain, maar maar ke chale jaate hain, hum log kitna takleef hota hai.
The world is coming for Hafiz Saeed, and the lie of no proof against him will not save him. With sanctions looming against Pakistan, is handing over Hafiz Islamabad's last and only hope. With Geeta Mohan in New Delhi, Bureau Report, NewsX.
So the Pakistani envoy, who is of course going on to other postings, I was going to say better, but I'd said other. We'll introduce my panel at this point now. Sudesh Verma, spokesperson of the Bharatiya Janata Party, right here with me in the studio. Vivek Katju joins us, former diplomat. Also with us will be Professor Madhav Nalapat, the editorial director of the Sunday Guardian, Lieutenant General Raj Khadian, former deputy chief of the Army Staff and a defense expert. Sultan Hali is our Pakistani guest tonight. He's a strategic affairs expert from Pakistan, also a regular guest on our shows. Good to speak to you, Mr. Hali, today. I do hope we'll have enough time to you, but let me start with Sudesh Verma. Today. Sudesh Verma, when the exclusive interview aired of Abdul Basit, he of course maintained predictable positions on a large majority of the issues that my colleague of course asked him about. But on the issue of the FATF kicking in, giving Pakistan 3-month notice, putting them on notice, and clearly saying that stop aiding, enabling and abetting these terrorists, these people who've been notified by intelligence agencies, otherwise face repercussions. Do you think the time window is now ticking? Do you think the world has suddenly become smaller for individuals like Hafiz Saeed?
You see, the interview which Mr. Basit gave to you shows the continuation of the Pakistani stand of being in denial mode all the time. You see, even in the case of Osama bin Laden, till he was found in Abbottabad, they were denying that Osama exists in Pakistan. So how to, you know...
And even after he got killed, the attitude was as if it never happened. It happened in Abbottabad, it happened in a Pakistani city where it was surrounded by army camps.
Yes. And you see, here, for world, it is a great challenge, you know, if the state becomes a rogue state, that they're going to always parrot the line they have been giving and they will not act. How are you going to make them behave as per international norms? The biggest challenge, we'll see after 3 months, whether Pakistan will actually act, is the biggest challenge facing mankind today.
You know,
how to make Pakistan behave.
I want to ask Vivek Katju, because I'm sure by now, Mr. Katju, you've seen parts of, at least if not the entire interview that Abdul Basit gave NewsX. And he, like I said before, maintained predictable positions, but he also was grilled largely on the issue of support to individuals like Hafiz Saeed. Now, after the FATF, the Financial Task Force notice to Pakistan, they are now saying that if there is strong evidence, the law of the land will take its course and he will be acted upon against. They've arrested him before. Do you think there's a difference after what the FATF has done and more pressure coming via perhaps the Trump administration or even from India then?
No, I think they are worried about the FATF because if financial sanctions kick in, then there is a great deal of inconvenience, if nothing else, for Pakistan. And that is why they've taken the FATF matter somewhat seriously. But on this question of enough evidence, the Pakistani stand has always been laughable.
Has not changed.
It was the same refrain with regard to terrorist acts in India, including 26/11. Now, the question is, who will collect the evidence? After all, these conspiracies are hatched in Pakistan. They are perpetrated in India, but the conspirators are always in Pakistan, so it's only Pakistan that can collect the evidence. No one else can give them their evidence. And it is here that they don't want to do anything. Because after all, these groups are instruments of the Pakistan state. And this whole term non-state actors is only a euphemism.
I want to involve Mr. Hali at this point. I want to refer him to what Khwaja Asif said in Germany.
Control of the Pakistan state.
One second. Sultan Hali, I want to take you back to what Khwaja Asif, your defense minister, had told a conference in Germany when asked directly about the question of JUD, Falah Insaniyat and Hafiz Saeed. He had said that we put him under house arrest under the National Security Act that you have, or the equivalent of that. But you haven't really put him on, booked him under terrorism charges. Now, since you do agree, and Khwaja Asif agrees in Germany, that he might be a threat to your system as well, what possible stoppage could there be to perhaps explore terrorism charges against him? Abdul Basit told my colleague that we haven't found any such charges, more evidence is needed. India has maintained for the past, I don't know how many years, that we've given you dossier after dossier, which not only convicts him, indicts him, but proves beyond a shadow of a doubt that not only was he mastermind of 26/11, and there are many others in Pakistan like him. And I've been told technology has failed me again, and he's just gotten disconnected, and I apologize to our viewers for that. But clearly, my kind of... I hope I didn't sound like a rant here.
No, not at all. What I described
was perhaps just factually completely correct what we've known for decades.
Not at all, Athar. You see, the way facts have come out, you know, you remember that their investigative agencies had come here. Why did we allow that? We allowed that because we wanted them to see the truth. And if after seeing all evidences, you know, actionable intelligence, evidences, and then also you stay in denial mode, say that no. And courtesy demanded that you would have invited India also to do their investigation.
And that was part of the plan initially. That never happened. It never fructified. We don't
know
why.
So how do you trust the neighbor like this? That's the whole point.
You know, I have Professor Nalapat back with me right now. Professor Nalapat, given the fact that the FATF means business, and I think Pakistan has at some level understood it means business, And I've been told Sultan Hali is back with us. But since the fact, Khwaja Asif saying this in Germany, the ambassador to India telling us what he thinks about it, they are taking it seriously, but not seriously enough to actually act on it and act on the intelligence and the evidence provided by India. Do you see that changing in the short term at all?
Are you asking me?
Well, whoever can hear me at this point.
Okay, let me answer your question. Definitely, Khwaja Asif, you see, who happens to be our defense minister.
Yes.
Khwaja Asif is a responsible person, and when he says that Hafiz Saeed should be a threat to us, he must be right. But the fact remains that we have to find ample evidence not to just to book him, but to also take him to the trial court and actually incarcerate him. And to do that, definite evidence is required, both from India and we are on our side looking for evidence. And if we find ample evidence, I'm sure...
You know, Vivek Katju is having a hard time not laughing at what you're saying, because we understand there is some sort of skepticism on both sides. I understand that, Mr. Hali, and so do you. Vivek Katju just wants to respond very quickly to what you've said right now. I will come back to you while we rectify that audio connection. Go ahead, Vivek Katju, respond to that.
Is there any dearth of evidence of the kind of approaches that Hafiz Saeed has taken on terrorism? Isn't there enough evidence already in the public domain and with the Pakistani agencies about what Hafiz Saeed and his group is all about? He does not hide these facts. Hafiz Saeed proclaims them to the world with pride. And here we are told by our Pakistani friends that we are trying to find evidence, actionable evidence, when it stares them in the face. Let's come clean on this. Pakistan has used Hafiz Saeed. And if you still want to deny it, then all that we can say is God help you.
And also then all the claims about Pakistan wanting to come to the table and wanting to discuss everything bilaterally, something Basit mentioned as well, ring completely hollow. I don't know if he has Sultan Hali back with us, and we're trying to get him back in a bit. Basit mentioned as well, ring completely hollow. I don't know if he has Sultan Hali back with us, and we're trying to get him back in a bit here, in a jiffy. But Sudesh Verma, the fact that isolating Pakistan is something that also the interview saw. And there have been attempts by India, conscious ones, deliberate ones in the recent past, and they've been successful to a large extent. And I think the panel would agree they've been successful. Pakistan, however, the envoy claims in that interview, that they don't believe they're isolated at all. And at one level, we understand because they have a big backer in China. How much of that is a concern for India? While we're looking to isolate Pakistan across the board, from Europe, there has been condemnation coming, but China is standing steadfast. How is the government tackling that bit?
You see, one thing is very clear, that India is not Pakistan fixated in its policy, you know. That is why we are masked.
But you pretend Pakistan is India fixated, because they don't have a choice.
Because they don't have a choice, and probably Kashmir is something that apparently they cannot go away from the stand they've taken. But we have been insisting that, of course, we can talk on terrorism, but beyond terrorism, no, because the whole world recognizes that, irrespective of your denial, that Pakistan has emerged as the center of terrorism, you know, fomenting terrorism all across the globe. So Pakistan must behave. You see, China's equation increasing with Pakistan is fine. If it is economic equation, we can't help about it.
There is increasing economic cooperation, something that we've spoken about in the past 2-3 years.
But that we cannot do anything about that. You know, any neighbor is free to have their own bilateral ties of economic relations, unless it becomes, you know, increasing into defense ties that can have a threatening proposition to India. India also has economic relations with China, and tomorrow, who knows that we become biggest partner of China,
you know,
as well.
Since we have Mr. Sultan Hali, I'm going to ask you, Mr. Sultan Hali, very clearly, the fact that the FATF, and if you look at the language of the wording of the FATF notices to Pakistan, they're in the same vicinity of what India has been saying. It's very clearly financial aid to terror outfits, or those outfits that masquerade as NGOs or perhaps social outfits, and the need to immediately clamp down on outfits and individuals like that. After the FATF directive, after the FATF notice, are you still in a position, or is anyone still in a position to deny that financial aid logistical aid, them being used as an overt political, socio-religious tool, as something of an extension of an arm of a state policy. Don't you think the FATF notices prove India's point?
Well, FATF, as Ambassador Kaju mentioned, is an inconvenience to us, and it is something which we are taking seriously. It is a coincidence that it is actually in consonance with what India is saying. But Pakistan on its own has taken the FATF notice very seriously, and we are trying our level best to look into it and see how we can remedy the situation. So why don't you give us a chance to actually take action on it?
But it sounds and looks suspiciously like Pakistan is stalling for time. Direct answer is something we had expected from Abdul Basit. He kept dodging and ducking, and he's a diplomat. Full credit to him for that. But the fact is, on the issue of clamping down financial aid to terror, something that is tangible now, something that is not India-originated, it's an international task force, just confirming what India has been saying. Do you really believe that stalling is the best tactic here? Don't you think that the world's getting smaller and more agencies, more and more pressures will come Pakistan's way unless you do address some home truths, however embarrassing they might be?
No, thank you so much for pointing it out. Hate organizations and those who are financing the terrorism, this is exactly what is inscribed in our national action plan. And we are very much at it. And the moment we are going to get evidence, especially against a person like Hafiz Saeed, appropriate action is definitely going to be taken.
Okay, so that I would count, Vivek Katju, I don't know how you interpret that, but that has been, to me at least, for the past 3 to 4 days, while talking to Pakistanis, be it Abdul Basit, saying that yes, we are willing to act against Hafiz Saeed if there is evidence. Or is this just another red herring? They'll never do it.
No, no, but as I've told you right from the beginning, let me repeat that. What does this mean if there is evidence? Isn't there sufficiently known facts about Hafiz Saeed's conduct? And who will collect the evidence? When these facts are there, it is for the Pakistani agencies, the Pakistani police establishment to collect the evidence. No one else can come and collect it for them.
Why hasn't that happened, Sultan Hali?
These are red herrings.
Direct question. Why hasn't that happened?
They are not serious. There are signs about non-seriousness.
I'm sure it's happening while we are speaking.
No, no, go ahead, Mr. Hali. Why hasn't that happened?
I'm saying that while we are speaking, I'm certain it is happening.
For more than 20 years.
Because the national action plan is something which the government of Pakistan is taking very seriously, and we are looking into it. And the moment we are able to gather ample evidence, and if India has some, please.
How many years since 2611, sir? 2611 happened in 2008. We are in 2017, sir. If by 9 years you cannot collect the evidence that is plainly in your sight, then I don't think we should take it seriously. Whether Mr. Basit says it, whether Mr. Nawaz Sharif says it, or whether any Pakistani guest commentator says it.
No, I'm afraid.
The question is, what does the DG ISI say?
I think that is the question. What does the DG ISI say? Let me go back to Professor Nalapat at this point and move back to India's efforts at getting our voice heard in terms of the terror that emanates from Pakistan directed at India. Professor Nalapat, by and large, we've been successful. If you've seen and tracked what has been happening at the Human Rights Commission in Geneva, at the UN, India's been, you know, giving it its full attention and has been largely successful. Pakistan still denies they're isolated, apart from China, really apart from China, Professor Nalapat. Do you see anyone backing Pakistan's position on these various issues?
To point out that people like Hafiz Saeed, the Lashkar-e-Toyba, they previously used to focus only on India, previously used to focus on single state of Kashmir, then they went across the whole of India. Today they're global. They are a threat in Europe, they are a threat in the United States. You see Pakistani nationals being picked up in all these places because of the terror threat and because of actual acts of terror. So they have become a global threat. But let me remind you that what this gentleman did in India was sanctioned by
the ISI. Let me finish that sentence for you. We lost Madhav Nalapat's connection there again. Sudesh Verma.
Yeah, you see,
I just completed a sentence for him. Yeah. Complete the thought here.
You see, Athar, the issue is about China. You see, China itself is suffering from terrorism. You know, sometime back, say about 10, 15 years back, when we used to talk about terrorism, people in the West used to say, you don't know to deal with your internal problem. This is your internal problem. Now the West has come to realize after WTC incident, you know, and when terrorism reached their border, because they thought that they were completely
isolated. So you're saying that China has its own extremist problem,
China is going to find it very tough to fight terrorism, the way the whole West failed.
But in that particular relationship, Sudesh Sharma, according to you, what overrides what? The CPEC has more consideration, or the fact that some extremists are coming through Pakistan in the Xinjiang province of China?
Because the terrorism has no friends. The terrorists are no friends of China or anyone.
What's the overriding factor in your view here? The CPEC, which has $46 billion at stake, or
of course the economic relations,
or a bit of a hiccup in terms of
extremists. Of course the economic relations. Yeah. China is bothered about its economic progress, and they want to capture the whole of Pakistan because it is going to help them find
so
a good
so more
economic
and more presence of Chinese.
But as is going to be impacted by terrorism, because terrorism do not see any religion.
Is back with us. Professor, coming back to your old point, and maybe go to Vivek Katju after this. Go ahead, Professor Nalapat.
I'd like to add that it's not just economics. The entire missile force of Pakistan has been developed by China. Its nuclear weapons have been developed because of China. If you go to Fatehgarh, you look at the nuclear plant. Even now, Chinese technicians are all over the place. So the Pakistan army, especially its missile forces, its nuclear forces, are heavily indebted. So this is the problem. Initially, Pakistan was able to get the protection of the United States. The United States used to blindly follow the Pakistanis, whatever they did, whatever misdeeds they did. And frankly, the United States several times used to ignore India's complaint. Today, that same role is being played by China, another superpower. The Chinese are in a situation where they are blocking action on terrorists, where they are ignoring whatever evidence the world community has got on Pakistan. So long as Pakistan has got a superpower backing it, the Pakistanis will do exactly what
Mr. Hali, respond to that. It's a clear case. India, of course, is convinced, and we've done enough, we've sent enough. I just want you to respond to the last point made by Professor Nalapat. China is a fair weather friend. Nobody is doubting that. For you, for Pakistan, I mean. But it has a relationship with India as well. And more, if you look at it recently, our relationship with China has increased if you look at trade. I mean, there might still be sort of a hostile in cases like Arunachal and others. But the fact is, India has to maintain a Chinese relationship, and that's not something you're alone in.
Well, I think you made a trident flip. You said that China is our fair weather friend. I would like to correct you. China is our all weather friend.
That was a slip of tongue. That's what I meant. I beg your pardon. I meant an all weather friend, not a fair weather friend. Yeah. Good at catching mistakes.
Pakistan not becoming a vassal.
I did mean an all weather friend.
Okay, I know that. I respect a lot. I read his columns in various newspapers, including some in Pakistan. He mentioned that the Chinese are helping us as far as the nuclear effort is concerned. I'm afraid that no foreigner, be it Chinese or anyone else, has been allowed to come even close to our nuclear effect. So I don't agree with that. But the fact remains that, you see, China is definitely, it has its interest in Pakistan. It will back us to the hill. But it is not a one-sided affair.
Athar, permit me to come in on this.
I will. I was going to.
Allow me to complete some sentence. The fact remains that Pakistan also has to deliver, and China has concerns on terrorism, which it has shared with us. It is also sharing intelligence with us, on which we are not only acting, but we are jointly trying.
Sir, India has been sharing intelligence with you for the past 25 years. Why do you refuse to take the Indian intelligence dossier seriously? Is it because India is not investing in a similar economic corridor? If that would happen tomorrow, would your tone change?
And Athar, don't they fear that Pakistan may become a vassal state of China?
Do join us. The more the merrier. We would love to have
the more the merrier. Now, that's what I want to hear. Vivek Katju wants to come in. Go ahead.
Vivek? Look, I think it's laughable to say that the Chinese have not assisted in Pakistan's nuclear weapons program. All scholars who follow nuclear issues know that the Chinese provided blueprints, the Chinese helped in Pakistani tests initially. So this is well recorded and it's well understood in the nuclear community. The strategic affairs community knows all this. Second, I think the China-Pakistan nexus is strong, but Pakistan has become almost a client state of the Chinese. The Chinese have little respect for the Pakistanis because Pakistan always does their bidding.
Just a cog in the wheel,
they want.
The cog in the big Chinese wheel.
The Pakistanis are always ready to oblige. These are hard facts.
All right, Professor Nalapat,
They treat Pakistan with disdain, whatever they want, the Pakistanis do.
All right. Professor Nalapat, quickly then, I'll take your closing comment. Then I have a specific question for Mr. Sudesh Verma, and we'll try and end with Sudhal Hali if we have the time. Go ahead, Professor Nalapat. Closing comments here.
You know, I simply want to say that I have a small disagreement with Vivek on this. The reality is that Pakistan has played its China hand very expertly, and they have now put themselves as an indispensable partner of China, including in fighting terrorism that's active in China. They did this with the United States. They succeeded for more than three decades with the United States, and the United States, in a sense, almost blindly supported them in whatever they did. And today that role has been taken over by China. So I would think that Pakistan, certainly, and the Pakistan state overall, has been very skillful in the way it has been dealing with
China. But is the world getting smaller now? Do you believe the world is getting smaller for Hafiz Saeed? Do you believe the world is getting smaller now? Because like you said, and you've been telling me for a long time now, the world has changed. There are different permutations and combinations. The world has a singular threat. It's terrorism. And most Western countries now realize that, Professor Nalapat, and have changed their attitude towards armed conflict, especially if it's Islamic terrorism anywhere.
Well, I'd like to say that change will come if two factors operate. One, the United States will join with India in trying to constrain Pakistan in a very action-oriented way. And two, the Chinese will at least be neutral. I see no sign of either happening at the moment.
All right. Very quickly, Sudesh Verma, before I go to Sultan Hali, and we have to come, we have come really close to the end of the show here. But one question, of course, since we speak about India trying to isolate Pakistan being mildly or largely successful, whichever way you want to look at it right now, do you believe ideas like promoting a bill that declares Pakistan a terrorist state or withdrawing MNF status or even putting our own version of economic sanctions on Pakistan is something the government is considering at this point?
You see, the government has already clarified, you see, we are guided by the Geneva Convention, you know, where we keep our diplomats and people-to-people contact. We don't have anything against the people of China. And the Prime Minister himself has appealed to the people of China.
But you're okay with FATF sanctions and other sanctions, maybe EU, maybe US?
Yeah,
but
of
India
course,
will not take
of
the lead.
Course, as many steps should be taken against Pakistan as possible in international world order to make Pakistan compliant.
But India will not
with this
take
this.
India
will of course lead. Take steps. India is going to cooperate. India needs cooperation of the whole world.
Okay, all right.
And this is a part of that.
All
but
right.
But you know, declaring Pakistan as a terrorist state, that is actually maybe not right now.
Not right now, you say. The parliament roundly rejected that particular
yes.
bill. I would have loved to speak a bit more on it, but I'm completely out of time, Sultan Hali. So next time, I'll come and start with you if I could. Thank you for joining us, by the way. And thank you for joining us, Professor Nalapat, Sudesh Verma, as well as Vivek Katju. It's time now for me to take a short break. The news continues. Debate number two coming up. My colleague Neha will do that. We are discussing the CRPF Jawan who took 16 bullets and is speaking directly opposite to what Farooq Abdullah, candidate for the Srinagar bipole, is saying. Stay with us.